here this evening? Unfortunately, I got a phone call from one of our up north brethren in Lebanon who said that they were not driving any further because they couldn't see where they were going because the fog's so bad up there. And that Brother Johnson, him and Christy, so they decided best not to try to go further. I know fog was forming here, but not as bad, hopefully. If you want to put somebody on the prayer list, Randy's got the cards here. He will do the announcing at the proper time. So if you would like a card to list somebody that's not on our prayer list currently, then raise your hand. And here we go. Randy will get you those. Go ahead and raise them big and high. We want to get everybody we can on our prayer list, of course, and so please let us know if you've got somebody there, or if you want even somebody maybe you mentioned last week that didn't get in the bulletin, you want to put it on there, that would be great too. Good. She wants more than I give her. It'll take her a while. Tonight we're going to continue our study of the life of Christ from the Gospel of Mark. David once said, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." Can somebody tell me why David could say that? For thou art with me. When we walk in the footsteps of Jesus, we have the encouragement that who walks with us?
God.
When we're obedient, doing what God wants us to do, faithfully, having been obedient to the gospel of Jesus Christ, we have the promises that God is with us. In fact, can anybody tell me what the name Emmanuel means? God with us. And sometimes that's easy to forget. We kind of carry weight of life on our own shoulders, don't we? But what can we do anytime we feel weighted, that life is getting us to a point we don't know if we're going to be able to wake up tomorrow and handle it? Yeah, we can pray. Absolutely right. Talk to God. And does that mean we just rattle off a quick prayer? Or does it mean we talk to God? It's so easy. We kind of get conditioned as kids. In Bible classes and even at home when we're saying, offering thank you for the prayer, for the food, and oftentimes saying my dad would come in, like for example, to have prayers with us before we went to bed, and it was just a very quick prayer that we didn't hardly even understand. But at least he did that. But we don't often hear people really talking to God, do we? But can we talk to God? Absolutely. Rocky, can you turn this mic down just a little bit? I want them to hear in the back, but it's pretty echoey right here. I'll bring this up so I'm not so far from it. Can you hear okay, Clifford, in the back there? You hear okay, Clifford? All right. I want to make sure he hears, but we're not ringing. You might come up just a hair, Rocky. Okay, testing, 1, 2, there we go. All right. Well, let's begin tonight. Somebody got the microphone? Okay. John, if you wouldn't mind, since you got it in hand, go ahead and if you would open this with prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day that you've given us, Father. We thank you for this time that you've given us to come and worship you, Father, and we just ask that you be with us throughout this period of Bible study and then devotion afterwards, Father, that we take the words that are spoken to us and apply them to our lives, that we take the songs and the prayers that are said and sung and we use them to encourage us but also to worship you, Father. And we thank you so much for all of the many blessings that you bestow upon us daily, Father, especially for that of your Son. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. When we look at the first part of Mark, it begins and opens with setting the stage for the book. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And that word gospel cannot be emphasized enough because it's simply a word that means what? Good news. You don't pick out too many newspapers and start out good news, right? How many books do you pick up and it starts out good news? Not too many. Except comic books. But I'm not sure they do anymore. But this is good news, and it's because Jesus was coming with a message. And that's the gospel of the kingdom, the good news of the kingdom. And it jumps into John the Baptist in Mark 1, which is immediate compared to looking at the other gospels who, two of those, start with genealogy and the birth of Christ and so forth. And then John conditions us by pointing out who Jesus is, that he was in the beginning with God and became flesh. But we have immediately here that Jesus is bringing the good news of the kingdom, and then John is there to prepare what? The way. I send my messenger before your face, and who will prepare your way before you? So John is revealed as that messenger preparing the way for the coming of Christ the Lord. The voice of one crying in the wilderness. And can you remember how John dressed? And if we were living in the 60s, we'd call him a what? Hippie. No, he was just a messenger. He was living off the grid, right? What was his food intake? Locust and wild honey, which is actually a pretty healthy combination. Protein and a natural sugar. Not a bad diet at all. And he was dressed in what kind of garment? Camel hair. So he was warm, didn't get cold, most likely. But he was more concerned with his work, and that was preparing the way, making the path straight for the Lord, as prophesied. And so who came to him? Obviously, Mark reveals Jesus came. And where was Jesus from? Nazareth. And why was Jesus called a Nazarene? From Galilee. Now, there were other folks that were Nazarenes in the sense of a vow. Now, we got folks today who are called Nazarenes. But you notice who was called the Nazarene? Jesus. And was he commissioning people to be called Nazarenes? Do we read about people being called Nazarenes? No offense to Nazarenes. Mrs. Bright, you have your hand up.
The ones that took the vow, were they called Nazarites?
They actually were. And sometimes you'll hear people refer to it Nazarene. But I think Scripture, you're right, Scripture calls them Nazarites. They've taken the Nazarite vow. And what was the sign of the vow? One of the indicators? Yes. So they did not drink from the grape, nor did they cut their hair. But I think it's interesting that Jesus came from Nazarene. He was called a Nazarene because of that. Was that being used in a religious sense, by the way? No, it was not. Now, in verse 11, Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. Was it for remission of sins? Because he had no sin. But John was baptizing for remission of sins, but it was a baptism of what? Repentance. And we go to the book of Acts. Did those folks that were baptized under John's baptism, were they in need of being baptized into Christ? Absolutely. And so that tells us a lot. But now Jesus is baptized, not to wash away sin, because he was sinless. And as a result, though, of his obedience, of course, set an example in a sense for us. But more importantly, he was pleasing to who? His Father. You are my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased. If a person is well pleased, they are satisfied.
Happy.
Happy, we could say that. Anything else you might want to add? Well pleased, satisfied, happy, blessed. Huh?
Set apart.
Righteous. Yes, because this is talking about being pleasing to who? God. How many of you set that for your goal? Our problem is, though, we will fall what? Short. Who makes up the deficit for us? Jesus Christ. And why can He do that? Because of what you read right there. We could have been in that water, but would it, we have heard these words? No, these words were qualified by who Jesus was and what He did or didn't do. He was sinless. He became that perfect sacrifice. Well, after that baptism, Scripture tells us in Mark, immediately, there's Mark's word again, the Spirit drove him into the wilderness. And what's going to happen there in the wilderness physically to Jesus? Going to happen both physically and spiritually. What primarily will occur physically to him? He's going to be fasting. He's been going to do so for how long? 40 days. And what happens when you fast for a considerably long period of time? You have to deal with changes to your body, and you will get hungry, of course. And if you're really, really in need of food, and you've gone a long time, and somebody comes along and says, "Larry, smell this." Can you imagine going 3 days without food and someone takes you into the Golden Corral, for example? Or better yet, someplace where there's like Jan's house home-cooked meal and her rolls are just flowing in the air. Well, you could be set up for some temptation, especially for me, if it's a great big old chocolate cake and there's a pile of ice cream right next to it. Or coconut cream pie over at your house, Carlene. It wouldn't take me long to be tempted. At the fellowship meal, I just went by and closed my eyes. Well, what happens to Jesus? He was tempted. And what was Satan questioning him about? If you are the Son of God, if you are who you claim to be, he was going to test him big time. It's almost like in my mind, when I'd say to my little brother, when I'd get him up on top of the roof of the house from the tree house, he could jump over from the tree house onto the roof, and my little brother Dennis, we'd made him some really good cardboard wings. I think I mentioned that before. And he was reluctant to jump, but we would do things like, "I dare you." Didn't take too many of those. Guess what he did? Should have went off on the grassy side instead of the parking side where it was gravel, but he survived it. Did Jesus survive his temptation? Yes. What was Jesus' power? Did he call down angels? Did he have to stop and pray to God and ask God what to do? At least we don't have a record of that. The angels came to comfort him after the temptation. But Jesus had a powerful weapon. What did he have? The Word of God. And that set the pattern for us to learn from. And, of course, following that, Jesus was comforted. And as Luke 4:13 says, when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. What does that tell us about Satan and temptation? He looks for that opportune time. It's a little harder to read in the box there, but... but that says a volumes, doesn't it? Will Satan leave us alone after temptation one time? Will he find our weakness? Will he set his set things in motion that will put that temptation in our way. But we do have a promise, and just to reiterate that promise, what will God not allow from Satan? As Bob says, to be tempted above that which we're able. He'll provide for us a way of escape. And can we use the same thing Jesus used? Yes, and that's the good thing. Now, after John was put in prison, Mark 1 verse 14, Mark tells us that Jesus came to Galilee. So now we have a Nazarene who was from Nazareth coming to Galilee. And what is significant about Galilee? There's Galilee of the Gentiles. What else is significant about Galilee? There's a lake there. And what about people living there? You had people living there. And it was kind of an interesting makeup of people there. But also you had the trade routes that came through the area of Galilee. You had lots of people. People liked to live there. It was a good climate and it was a place of active trade. Rome was there involved. You had the powerful of Rome who would often use that, as we might call it, their lake homes. You also, as you remember, had to, we deal with the Gentiles there. You had to deal with those, the demon-possessed man that was in the caves. But it was an important area. And once again, what is Jesus doing when he goes to Galilee?
He's teaching,
preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. And there was the follow-up in verse 15 and saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Now that was written in what century? First century. Yet a lot of people are telling folks that the kingdom was not established, it didn't come, and it's still yet to be in the future. Do you see a problem with that? What does it say here? The time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Therefore, that meant there was a responsibility handed to the listener. And what was it? Somebody was saying it out here. Repent and believe the good news, the gospel. Because the time is fulfilled. Now, does Mark reassure us that what Jesus spoke was true? Despite all the folks saying, no, the kingdom hasn't come, it's still going to come. One of these days, Jesus is going to come to this earth. He's going to sit on the throne in Israel and Jerusalem, and all will be well. Is that what we're reading? Janet?
He's never going to be on this earth again.
No passage says that Jesus will set a foot back on this earth. Not one. But Mark tells us something very important in Mark 1. 9:1. Can somebody read that real quick for us? Mark chapter 9, verse 1. Some of those standing there, Bob says, will not taste death till they see what? God coming with power. If it did not come in the first century, that means today we got some very, 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 very old what? Disciples and some people. But did it come? When did it come? In fact, Colossians 1:13 clears it up. Somebody want to read that for us real quick? Or quote it? So basically, summary, delivered us, talking to the church at Corinth, Christians, delivered us from darkness, conveyed us, or translated, the New King, or King James says, New King James says, convey us into what? Kingdom of the Son. Did it come like Jesus said it would? Yes. What was the mistake people made with reference to what Jesus preached about the coming of the kingdom? What were they looking for? They were looking for the physical kingdom, a physical king like the manner of David, because it was prophesied there would be a king from Judah after the likeness of David, after the order of Melchizedek, as we find out in Hebrews. But they were looking for what? a physical king to sit on their throne and be the world empire leader. Well, Jesus was the world empire leader, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. But the problem was they were looking for something physical. So they missed what? What Jesus was really talking about. And say it again. The spiritual kingdom. And that is good news. Folks, it's not good news with an earthly kingdom, is it? Even if we got free food for life, even if we were constantly at peace, even if we had beautiful weather, perfect climate, would that satisfy our need? Would a physical kingdom satisfy our need? What would man need? A spiritual kingdom. That's what we need. And so that's what Jesus brought us, the kingdom of God. And time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. That means it's within reach. It's near. And that is a truth we cannot miss. Well, Jesus begins his public work among people. He's only got a short period of time. What's he going to need to carry forth his work after he ascends to heaven?
He needs other people.
He needs people. Does the church need people?
Yes.
Why? Because we got the same mission, right? What's the same plan? We have to keep spreading the truth, the word of God. We got to spread the good news of what? The kingdom. And one of the things I like to do when I'm talking to someone, I get the opportunity to point out, especially if they believe in a coming of a literal physical kingdom, I say, we don't need it. We need what Jesus brought us, a spiritual kingdom. But he's going to need people to pass that message along. So as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, and we wonder why Jesus is here, what's he going to find in the Sea of Galilee? Fishermen. And so he saw Simon and then who? Andrew's brother casting net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Well, they're still going to be fishermen, only what kind are they going to be? Follow me, I will make you become fishers of men. And there's Mark's word again. I'll keep emphasizing that throughout our study. They waited till the next day. Oh, wait a minute. Virginia, that's not what it says. They immediately left their nets and followed him. Does that tell us they believed what Jesus was saying? Does it tell us they saw something maybe in Jesus or knew something about him? They didn't hesitate. They immediately left their nets, followed him. And we don't know all of what they knew or what was going on, but we know enough to know that they made a decision to follow Jesus. And when he had gone a little farther from there, he saw who? James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who was also a son of who?
Zebedee.
Who were also in the boat mending their nets. And why was mending the nets important?
Well, they were fishermen, and you have to have good, strong nets.
Or you lose fish, or could lose the whole catch if it breaks free. Well, what was their decision? Well, immediately Jesus called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and went after him. Now, isn't that awful that boys just will leave their father and take care of all the work? No? My grandson, every time I turned around when he was helping me at the house, he was gone. I'd go in and find him on his phone. I wasn't too happy. Well, we don't read that Zebedee was not happy, do we? But we also do read something very important that Mark wanted to include for us. Who was there to help Zebedee? Hired servants. So they weren't leaving their father high and dry, were they? They didn't put him out of business, but they saw a business more valuable than fishing for fish, mending nets. Well, as Jesus would begin his work, one of the things he would do is to confirm who he claimed to be. And how did he do that?
With miracles,
healing. And immediately, his fame, not only because he spoke with one having authority, but he also proved who he was by the miracles he did. And when you get somebody healing, folks, and they're really healed, especially of things that current medicine cannot heal, then what happens? People believe it, and fame spreads. They start talking about it. And what's the best publicity you can get? A newspaper or story or word of mouth? Word of mouth. And look at what Luke says about it in verse 37, chapter 4. The report about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. So throughout Galilee, the word was spreading, and it was a fairly populated area around the lake because of being a lot of people there because of the lake, both for supplying a living and also a nice place to live, good climate, and also be on the trade routes, active with people. And this would then ultimately produce a what? Starting with an M. Multitude. And that would be wonderful for the most part. Verse 32 in Mark 1, we read the words, at the evening when the sun had set, they brought to him all who were sick and those who were demon-possessed. And then verse 33, what do we read?
The whole city
was gathered at the door. How'd you like to hear your doorbell and open it up and you got the whole city in your front yard? Wow. Whole city gathered together at the door. What did Jesus do with his ministry? He healed many who were sick with various diseases, cast out many demons, did not allow the demons to speak. And why not?
Because they knew who he was.
Demonology is an interesting study in the New Testament because obviously it involves demons who are unique by the fact they were possessing people. But why were they there? What do we read about them? Right, to be there to show that Jesus had power over who?
Satan.
No question. No question at all. In fact, he was accused of casting out Satan by the power of Satan, Beelzebub. That was clear. They understood who Jesus had power over. And that's important that people today even understand that. They were there for a specific reason, and it was to prove who Jesus was and what he had power over. Also to show people that the words he spoke were from God. And also showing, when you think about in the spiritual realm, that they had knowledge that a lot of human beings did not and wouldn't even come to know that Jesus was who he claimed to be, the Son of God. Well, in verse 45, we read the words that he went out and began to proclaim freely. And this is talking about the man who was healed, if I remember right. I should have refreshed my memory. And so this spread. And so what was the result of going out and speaking? It created a crowd problem. Jesus could no longer openly enter the city, but was outside in deserted places. Did that stop folks?
No,
that's not a deterrent in this case. So they would come out to Jesus. And notice I like what Mark says there in verse 45. And they came to him from what? Every direction. That's phenomenal that folks were intent on being able to be there with Jesus. But Jesus had done some phenomenal things, like there was Simon's wife who was healed, and many healed on the Sabbath. And then it's just amazing the things Jesus did and the attention he got. Roy? Great point. They didn't need the TV or radio, did they? What Jesus was doing was a word that spread like fire. So what does Jesus need to do? You don't mind, when you think about it, being around people so much, or at least most of us don't, but there does come a point when you want to do what? Go home and do what? Get alone? Or doing go home. As we read here, and now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out, departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. Is there value in what we see Jesus doing for us? Why is morning good for most of us, particularly as we age? You're fresh. How many of you are like me at night when you lay your head down on the pillow, there's all this stuff just going through your mind? And I admittedly, when I start to pray, sometimes I'll find that I've left the prayer mentally and I'm somewhere else, thinking about something going on or going to happen. But in the mornings, I can get up, thanks to my cat, about 6, 6:30, sometimes earlier, but I try not to let her do that. Like this morning, she and I were up at 6. I fed her, then I went and started my Bible reading. And after that, I prayed. And I noticed that my mind's much fresher, and I also remember much more. When it comes to this time in the night, evening, I find that my mind is going into neutral too easy. So this time is a good time. And what's the advantage of being in a place where there's no noise? Concentrate. How many of you have been praying and your phone rings? Happens a lot. So thankfully, I got those things where you can turn the ringers off. And some of you call me in the morning, and I'll realize maybe when I look at my phone in mid-morning that, oh, wow, I missed 3 calls already. And then I'll put them on a list to call back, and sometimes I get to them, and sometimes I don't. And I apologize for that. But there is value in that silence. Mark chapter 2, where is Jesus going to go? He entered Capernaum after some days, and it was heard that he was in the house. So he's traveling now, but yet still people hear that he's in the house. What has been spreading along with Jesus? What is due? I wanted to put this slide back in here for the review because it is looking at a modern building there in Capernaum next to some ruins. And what's interesting is those ruins have what we would call a million-dollar view. If you were a real estate agent and you could sell one of those houses, how easy would it be to sell? At least the ones on the front. The lake view, you got a lake view site close to the water. Could you eat fresh fish if you lived there? If you're a fish eater, oh yeah. But in biblical times, Capernaum was one of the main trading villages in the Gennesaret area. It was a vibrant, prosperous part of Palestine, home to about 1,500 people, many of whom were fishermen. But also you had the travelers, the caravans, the traders that passed through Capernaum on a route called Via Maris, I think they pronounce it. It was a main trade route connecting Damascus in the north to Egypt in the south. So you had goods traveling both directions. And what would that mean for you living in Capernaum? Would you want for anything at Walmart? Would you need a big grocery store? No. This was the place to be. And because you had the trade route, you also had the government involved. And what would the government do on this trade route? What did governments do? They tax. And so because of that, who is Jesus going to encounter? We'll read about it a little bit more in Matthew, the tax collector. But verse 2 says, "Me and the many gathered together, so there was no longer room to receive them, not even near the door." And what did Jesus do? What he had been doing. He preached the word to them. Now, whose word? What was the message? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom is coming. Where'd he put John? He didn't get to work too long because he did what? He told people like it was. They need to repent. And that message doesn't resonate with everybody, particularly when it comes to kings or leaders, rulers, and their family. In fact, what happened to John's head? He was beheaded. Why? Thank you. Why was John beheaded? Yeah, John said something they didn't want to hear. He didn't have a right to have her as a wife. And that's not a popular message, never has been. And so and John got in a difficult situation. But John was to have a limited message for a limited time for a limited people, wasn't it? Or wasn't he? I think I said that right. But he was put in prison. Jesus comes to Galilee. What's he going to be doing again? Mark 1:14, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, which is the review. And so it's Jesus at the forefront. But because John had enemies for preaching the truth, what would Jesus have? Enemies for preaching the good news of the gospel of the kingdom. Why would people get upset at good news? They didn't like it. They don't want to believe it. They don't want to do it. They want to change. And even though Jesus was proven with his words by his miracles, they just didn't want to accept it. And so we have now some of the scribes, in verse 6, Mark 2, were sitting there reasoning in their hearts. Now reasoning is good. It's to think things to a conclusion. It's what the literal word means. To think the things out, to reason, to bring it to a conclusion whereby we understand the conclusion. But sometimes man's reasoning is not what? The way of man is not in himself. It's not in man to do what? Direct his own steps. Because when they see Jesus doing these things, they make an accusation. What is the accusation here? Larry?
Well, I had a comment.
Okay. Well, to answer the question, what is Jesus doing? He says, why does this man speak what? Blasphemies. Larry?
Well, I was thinking about Jesus came to the earth, and he began his earthly ministry there around the Galilean coast, and he picked up some of his would-be apostles later. That he was changing the way of life that they had practiced for 2,000 years. So today, when we talk to people about a change in the way of life that maybe they have become accustomed to, so it's hard to bring them out of that because it's a way of life for them.
That's right.
And so the Lord had a problem with it, and he said, you're going to have the same problem. Because the servant's no greater than his master.
Very good point. One of the things that, and I'm sure you've experienced the folks working in the jail, and I've experienced in Bible studies, Kathy and I together, is we'll spend a lot of time listening to people's misery. They're miserable. From family trouble, children to breakups, to financial difficulties, to the problems that alcohol has created for them, or drugs, and the list goes on. And yet when it comes down to making the change that's necessary in life that can change all that, they will what?
They don't want to do it.
They resist. They're hesitant because they don't really want to do what? Change. And you think, why? They're miserable. Why not? I've walked away from people that are literally miserable. One of the studies recently we had, it was a very difficult home setting situation that this person was involved in. It was affecting their children and not changing. Why not? What you're in, involved in, is not good for you. This is good news, but people still will reject what? And then, as you know, people will not only not accept, but they will end up turning on you, the messenger. So they do that to Jesus. This man's speaking blasphemies. Well, under the Old Testament law, that accusation, if it was true and could be proven, would necessitate what? A death penalty. And what is their argument and their reasoning? What's the next question? And notice they're doing this question-wise. Why does this man speak blasphemies like the question? And here's their follow-up question, which says it all. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Well, that statement, if you turn it into a statement, only God can forgive sins, is true. But what they could not see is that Jesus was God. So they conclude in their reasoning, despite all the miracles and the authority in which Jesus spoke and the way he spoke, that he therefore had to be a blasphemer, thus worthy of death. But then, verse 13, we read that this didn't stop Jesus. So what does Jesus do in verse 13? Back to what he was doing. Like the apostles, when they were put in prison, told not to speak and teach in the name of Jesus anymore, what did they do? They went back teaching and preaching Jesus. And counting themselves blessed in that they were worthy of being what? To suffer for Jesus. So Jesus didn't stop. The multitude came to him and he taught them. And that was his mission, to bring to them the good news. But also during this account, we read in Mark 2, verse 14, that Jesus passed by, and who does he see?
Levi.
And who's this? The son of Alphaeus, which we know, we often call him what?
Matthew.
Mark calls him Levi. Saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax office, and he said to him, "Follow me." And we don't have the word immediately, but it looks like he pretty much did. Because what do we read? Now for Matthew, Peter, James, they and John, they left, and Andrew, they left a fishing business. But what kind of business is Matthew leaving? Which one was probably the most lucrative? Especially in some of the things that have been recorded in history, is that where Matthew was at was a very busy, put it that way, and then ultimately lucrative place to be as a tax collector. Because when they collected taxes, they had to turn over to the government, but what did they do? They took their share, and some would take a lot more than their share. They raised the price of the tax.
Tax collectors today get a percentage of all that they collect. So it's no different today than it was then, except that at the time that Matthew was called, if you were dishonest, you could charge them whatever you wanted to.
Yeah.
It's
like in some countries, you go down the road, you'll have people there, just citizens, stop you and expect you to pay a toll. And nobody really argues with them because it's better just to pay them and go on, right, than to fight them. And that even happens in India. You get stopped all along the way, but that's kind of interesting. We'll pick up with Mark chapter 2, go to chapter 3 and 4 and 5 in our further study, Lord willing, next Wednesday night. Appreciate your attention tonight, and we'll move on to our devotional here pretty quick. Thank you, Gina. Get to our devotional here. There we are. I could have kicked.
Good evening. Does anybody need a prayer request? I've got forms here, and I can hand you a pen if anybody needs one. We announced it earlier, but that was during the auditorium class, so making sure somebody else didn't need it. Updates, Judy and Ellen both are doing, after their surgeries, are both doing relatively good, so we're thankful for God for those answered prayers. Andrew, Jennifer's son, he's still dealing with the flu and those symptoms along with that, so need to continue to keep Andrew in our prayers. Joe's friend, Ray Slocum, still needs our prayers. Let's see. When you fill out these cards, as a reminder, when you fill the cards out, especially if it's a friend or a relative, just anybody, be sure and put your name there too, so we kind of know if it's a sister or a, you know, kind of how the tie is. And sometimes you have names, and maybe the first time we heard that name, so it might help. But Shula's got a friend, Art Medley, and he's struggling with addiction, so need to keep Art in our prayers. Also, June's daughter, Trevor Robinson, Treva, she fell and has got several injuries, and I mean, some of them sounded pretty serious when I talked to June, so if you want details, you can talk to June, but she for sure needs our prayers. She said that her son, her brother Jacob, is still not doing too good, so he's dealing with eye problems. He has been cleared to have the Botox injection, so maybe they will help her. Gina's sister Nancy's dealing with the flu since Monday, so keep Nancy Porter in your prayers. Wanda's sister Betty, Scott's sister Beth, Roger, they're all dealing with that dreaded disease, and at least Betty, hospice being called in, so we just need to keep Wanda and that family and Betty in our prayers. My brother Roger found out day before yesterday, he's got cancer now besides in his neck, and so they're not real hopeful on that situation. In fact, St. Louis has told him they've probably done all they can do for him, and so that's where that is. But anyway, I still covet prayers for spiritual healing, especially in his case, and anything else is icing on the cake if some way he comes out of this. But anything I might have missed, let's go to God in prayer, please. Holy Father, we're very thankful, Father, that each and every one of us have an opportunity to be here this evening, Father, that a lot of people don't, or they don't take advantage of. Father, we're thankful for the measure of physical and mental health that we do have, that, Father, we can come here and study a portion of your word, Father, that we can sing songs of praise to you, Father, that we can strive to learn better how to serve you by serving others. Father, our sincere desire is to love you like you first loved us and sent your son to show us how much you loved us, that he died for us, that knowing that this earth is not our eternal home, but you've provided for us, if we just obey the gospel and strive to live a life that would bring you honor and glory, that your grace and mercy might abound. Father, we're mindful of those that I just now mentioned, we're also mindful of those that's been on the prayer list for quite some time. We would ask your richest blessing on each and every one of them. Father, as is your will. Father, be with us. Guide us in all that we do. Help us to serve you by serving others, and that all things are done for your honor and glory. Humbly ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you're using the book, it's 541. 541 if you're using the book. Shining every day, there's a rainbow of love o'er the land and sea. There's a rainbow of love. A rainbow shining with golden lining. It's always pointing to heaven above. The kind that gather on stormy weather. There's a rainbow of love. When we cross the tide, there's a rainbow of love shining on and on. There's a rainbow of love. There's a rainbow shining with golden lining. It's always pointing to heaven above. The clouds that gather, the shiny weather, there's a rainbow of love. Song of Invitation to Miss 461. 461.
Good evening. Does that sound all right back there? Too loud? This evening's lesson is going to be on repentance. I'd like to start it off with Psalm 119, verses 174 through 176. As you're turning there, you may be either unlucky or lucky, but this is a sermon that I did a while back, and I'll try to cut it down as much as I can so we're not here until like 9, but we'll see. Psalm 119, 174 says, I long for your salvation, O Lord, and your law is my delight. Let my soul live and praise you, and let your rules help me. I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek your servant, for I do not forget your commandments. And so I want to spend some time as we go through this lesson thanking about a topic that we all know very well, right? Repentance is a topic that all of us have heard about basically from the moment that we started coming to church services. And so our lesson's going to center around this, but I want to look at the definition of repentance as defined in the 1828 revision of Webster's Dictionary. Repentance is defined as sorrow for anything done or said, the pain or grief which a person experiences in consequence of the injury or inconvenience produced by his own conduct. And the King James Bible Dictionary describes three different Greek words for repentance: metamelomai, metanoeo, and metanoia. Each of these words describes a different form of repentance. Metamelomai is regret without a change of heart. Metanoeo, sorry, my Greek is not very good, is a change of one's mind and purpose. And finally, metanoia, which is a complete repentance. And so I want to look at three different examples briefly. I'll paraphrase these examples. But each one of these presents a different form of repentance, and I want to look at how we can apply each of these to our lives. So coincidentally, the first example I want to look at is Jonah. So if you want to turn over there, we'll be going briefly through every chapter of the book, but trust me, we'll be just briefly touching on this. Jonah was called by the Lord, we see in the first part of the book. He called Jonah to go spread a warning to the people of Nineveh. He was going to be the mouthpiece of the Lord. But Jonah, whether by their reputation or what, was scared of the people of Nineveh. And so he decides to run away, right? Jonah realizes the Lord is angry with him because he runs away. And so there's a storm, and lots are drawn, straws are drawn, and Jonah is deemed to be the reason, and he is the one that's thrown overboard. So he gets swallowed by a fish after the Lord sent the storm. And inside this fish, Jonah realizes that he was wrong. So we see the first time in this story, and the only time, that Jonah actually repents. He begs the Lord for forgiveness. He repents, although this type of repentance was that first type that we learned of, metamelomai. He was sorry for his actions, but did nothing to change them. And so he preaches after being spit out onto shore to the people of Nineveh. And when they actually repented of their sins and turned away from the evil that had become encompassed in the city, the Lord forgave them and decided not to destroy them, and Jonah gets angry. And so Jonah went to pout underneath a tree. When confronted about his mindset by the Lord directly, Jonah misses his opportunity for true repentance. He sits there and still pouts, and we know Jonah did many good things for the Lord, but in the end, he fails to see that his good works were for an actual purpose, and his initial repentance was all for naught. 2 Samuel chapters 11 and 12 outlines David's sin and when he looks upon Bathsheba. So we see David looking upon Bathsheba, and he called Bathsheba to his quarters. He commits adultery, and don't forget, David isn't even supposed to be in Jerusalem at this time. This is when kings and generals and their armies went out to go to war, right? And so David knows after he commits this act that he did wrong. Bathsheba tells David that she's with child, and David immediately springs into action. In this case, David repents in a way. He knows he did wrong. He even feels guilty for it, right? He tries to cover it up, but at first, this doesn't change him. So David tries to cover up his sin by getting Uriah, the actual husband of Bathsheba, to lie with her. David sins again to cover up his previous wrongdoings. This time, it leads to the death of Uriah, who was coincidentally one of his closest friends. And so we see at the end of this story, David finally repents. This is when David makes a full repentance. His son is taken away from him. This combined with Nathan telling him how grievous his errors were opened David's eyes, and he seeks the full repentance and the forgiveness of God. And so David fully understands that only God can forgive him, right? He can't cover up, no matter how much he tries, his cover-ups for his sins won't ever take that guilty conscience away from him. They won't ever forgive him. He won't ever forgive himself. Only God can forgive him. And we can see that David is fully committed to his repentance because of what he says, what we read in our opening scripture in Psalm 119. And so the final example that I want to look at is Saul. And Saul is possibly the greatest or the most prevalent story of repentance that we see in the New Testament. Saul's background was a murderer and a prosecutor of the Lord's church. Saul to the point of Acts 9, where, if you want to turn and look at what I'm paraphrasing, did not realize what he was doing wrong. He thought that he was in the right. He thought he was doing what those higher up than him in the Jewish faith, what his bosses, so to speak, wanted him to do. And he was doing what he thought God wanted him to do. And so Saul was continuing to breathe threats to the church, and he was on his way to do what we can only assume would be a normal day's work for him of persecuting the church, murdering Christians, or throwing them in prison for who knows how long. But on the road to Damascus, all that changed. The Lord comes to Saul and tells him what he was doing wrong. And so Saul does what we should all do when we realize we're wrong. Immediately, he listened to what the Lord had to say. Just like what Rick was saying with the disciples when they were called. Immediately like that, he listened. And when he realized he was wrong, he did what he had to do. He went to the house of Judas and met Ananias, who further educated him about the Lord. Was Paul's repentance genuine? We see that from that point on, Saul fully devotes his time, his work, his body, his life to the work of the Lord. Paul, at this time now, does a complete 180, turns away from a life of comfort, prosperity, and power because he knew what he was doing was wrong. And when Paul was shown the true impact of what his actions were, he immediately sought to make it right. And so this is how our repentance has to be. We have to realize our actions have consequences. When we sin, our actions have consequences. In the case of Jonah, his consequences are unknown. We don't exactly get to hear about what happens to him after the Lord talks to him. But we know the Lord saw his attitude and behavior as poor enough to warrant a direct conversation with Jonah, don't we? And we still don't have any idea what his response was. In David's case, his actions led to the death of one of his closest friends and a newborn child and countless others. Saul's actions were similar. He was persecuting and killing countless Christians, trying to do God's will. But when you look at Paul and David, they have one thing in common. They committed heinous sins, and both still were given the opportunity to repent by God. Both took that opportunity in the end, but what the Lord looks for isn't just repentance. He wants a full change of heart, and when we repent, we commit, albeit probably not what we should consider to be the same magnitude as David or Saul, but we still must turn completely from these sins that we commit, right? We must commit to lead a fully changed and devoted life for Christ. So if there's anybody here tonight who is in need of following the Lord or in need of any prayers, we ask that you come forward as we stand and sing our invitation song.
In our dismayed, whatever be done, God will take care of you. Beneath the wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. Through days of toils when heart does fail, God will take care of you. When dangerous fears your path assail, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. All that you need, He will supply. God will take care of you. Nothing you ask will be denied. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon his breast, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day that you have blessed us with. Father, especially for this time that we could gather here to study from your word. Father, we thank you for being with our number who have been sick. We thank you for their improvement. And we had asked that they could continue to improve. Father, we thank you for the knowledge and the wisdom that you give doctors that help care for us. Father, thank you for your congregation here. Help us to be a light in this community. Father, we'd ask you to go with us as we go to our separate homes. In your son's name, amen.
Tonight we have a young man who is 85.